It's not all glorious over on Team Blue. This New York Times Siena poll is not good.
Right.
Not good at all. It's got so much juice in it. I mean, I want to go over the specifics, but it's showing that it's, you know, Trump's up 1 point over Kamala Harris. But the interesting thing is he's never up 1 point. I mean, he's the past couple of election cycles, right, he was down 9 to Joe Biden at this point. I think he was down, 2 to Hillary Clinton at this point in the election cycle. And think about that. So he was down 2 to Hillary in 2016 at this point. He's now up 1 over Harris. He beat Hillary Clinton.
Right, right.
And he came within, you know, 20,000 votes in the swing states of beating Joe Biden, even though Joe Biden was up 8 over him at this point. So now Trump's up, which has the left completely melting down. And here are some of the reasons. This is the biggest one. Do you think Kamala Harris represents change or more of the same? 55%, she represents more of the same. Only 25% say major change. 15% say minor change. But the vast majority say she's more of the same.
Right.
Donald Trump, 53% see him as a major change. And the people want change. 60% of them, 61% say the next president should represent a major change from the Joe Biden era.
You know, and that's really remarkable when you consider the resistance. Media Research Center looked at ABC, NBC, CBS. Even though they don't have the same power they used to have, the nightly news programs, they still probably generate around 30 million people every night. And a lot of the other news outlets get their cue from them. 85% of their coverage of Harris-Walz has been positive. 90% of the coverage of Trump-Vance has been negative. You consider that, and the 2.5-year collusion nonsense. The Hunter Biden laptop story was diminished by 51 intelligence officials, and you had platforms like Facebook and like Twitter shutting down that story. You have Mark Zuckerberg spending $419.5 million of his own money on election officials in heavy Democrat areas to get out the Democrat turnout. All of that, and the man is still even in the polls. Can you imagine what would happen if we had a fair media, a media that didn't have 93% of journalists as registered as something other than Republican? Only 7% of journalists are Republican. If we had a fair-minded media, this would be a runaway. It would be a joke. Keep in mind, Bill Clinton said, it's the economy, stupid. The issue is, are you better off now than you were a year ago? If you answer that question, the only people who are better off now are illegal aliens. The average American is not. That should be that simple. If it weren't for the biased media and how they focus on nonsense that Trump says and they don't focus on the stuff that he says that matters,
yep,
we wouldn't be having this conversation.
Here's what's nuts. The left, of course, doesn't see it that way. I mean, it's amazing, the hate. This guy, Aaron Rupar, who's just one of the worst. He was with Vox. Now he's on his own.
Mm-hmm.
He tweets out, whether he ultimately gets 48 or 45% of the vote, Trump having this level of support is evidence of a profoundly sick society. We're sick because we don't see him as the Hitler-esque figure that Aaron does.
Yeah.
And that is representative of most of the leftist reaction to this New York Times Siena poll. It is the gold standard.
Right.
There's no better poll.
Right.
And they are in tears over the fact that it's tight.
You know, this business about Donald Trump being a Nazi, this is standard Democrat fare. Ronald Reagan was called, a congressman said, Ronald Reagan gets his fascist precepts from the pages of Mein Kampf. When Barry Goldwater was nominated in 1964, the governor of California said, the stench of fascism is in the air. George Herbert Walker Bush was called compared to Joseph Goebbels by George Soros. So they do this all the time. The reason for Donald Trump getting more than anybody else is because he's taken on the media. He's called them fake news. And so now people trust the media less than at any other time in America, and it's because of Donald Trump. That's why they dislike him so much. There's another reason they dislike him. When he ran in 2016, he was a joke. He was on CNN. He was on MSNBC all the time. Why? Because their numbers went up when he was on. They considered him to be a caricature, a cartoon character. They knew he wasn't going to go anywhere. So what's the problem? Put him on. Numbers went up, numbers went up, numbers went up. Then he began picking off all of his rivals one after another. And they realized, oh my God, I've created a monster. So they felt responsible in part for Donald Trump's popularity, and they blamed themselves. Add to that, Donald Trump calls him fake news, and he is their number one enemy. That's why they dislike him so much.
Mm-hmm. Oh, it's a great analysis. You're exactly right. A little bit more from the left. Bill Kristol, distressing, depressing, alarming. After everything, January 6th, after clear evidence, a second term would bring far more authoritarian, would be far more authoritarian than the first. After the ever-increasing radicalization of MAGA world, Trump now has more support than he had in 16 or 20. So that's right. He does have more support than in 16 or 20. Yeah. Maybe they should stop and think about why and actually think about what they've done to drive his numbers up.
And you mentioned Bill Kristol from the left. He used, of course, be on the right. That's how tragic this whole thing is. I'm amused by this business about democracy being on the ballot, because for 4 years when Donald Trump was president, you had Hillary Clinton referring to him as illegitimate, her word, and saying the election of 2016 was stolen, her word. There was a poll, a YouGov poll, that found 66% of Democrats believe that the Russians changed vote tallies in 2016 to get Donald Trump elected. Obama's DHS Secretary, Jay Johnson, testified under oath. The Russians failed to change a single vote tally. They tried, but they failed to change a single vote tally. 66% of Democrats believe the Russians changed vote tallies to get Donald Trump elected in 2016. Jay Johnson also said, you know, as far as the impact of the Russian interference on popular opinion, I don't know. I'd have to have a world where there was Russian interference, one where there wasn't. Compare the two, since I can't do that. I'd have to be a mind reader. I don't know. But there was a study done by NYU Stern School of Management that looked at the impact of the interference, and they found that it was barely measurable. 78% of Democrats, according to Gallup, believe that the Russian impact altered public opinion. So my long way of saying, a greater percentage of Democrats believe 2016 was stolen than we feel that way about 2020. But nobody accuses them of undermining the foundation of our republic. It's a double standard. It's hypocrisy.
It's so true. Even last week with this indictment of two Russians and who were accused of starting this podcast network with more conservative-leaning hosts, it was like, they're interfering again. And we actually took a hard look at the allegations of the indictment. There's one paragraph, one, that actually suggests true interference, where someone who was allegedly Russian funneled a message down to a podcaster saying, we think the attack on Russia was done by Ukraine, not by ISIS. Mm-hmm. And allegedly the podcast host said, you know, I'm happy to talk about that. That's it. One guy who, I mean, it really is not that popular, with all due respect. I don't know exactly which one it was, but I know it wasn't Tim Pool, and I know it wasn't Dave Rubin, and the others are nowhere near as popular as those two.
Right.
And that's it, Larry. The leftist led the New York Times. It was all over, like, the Russians are in here. One podcast host making one comment in a whole YouTube channel that over the course of a year only had 16 million views. As I said to the audience, we get that in a few days.
Right.
It's absurd.
It advances the agenda that the Russians want Donald Trump to be president. Never mind that Vladimir Putin just came out and said, I support Kamala Harris.
But I think he was trolling. There's zero chance he actually supports Kamala Harris. I mean, who knows? That's Putin. But in any event.
Well, if I were Putin, I would support Kamala Harris. Why wouldn't I?
Yeah, I know, right? Her policies would be better.
Exactly.
Yeah, I know. But, you know, he's got to.
Can I say one more thing about the election interference stuff? Donald Trump is blasted for using whatever means he could legally to overturn, to use their word, the election in 2020. It seems to me, if I'm a Biden supporter, I would want Trump to exhaust every legal means he feels necessary so that the American people can be confident that the election was fair. In 2000, when Al Gore lost to George W. Bush, about a dozen House members tried to overturn Florida the following January, claiming that the Supreme Court unlawfully stopped the count. 4 years later, when George W. Bush got reelected, 30 House members plus Barbara Boxer here in California tried to overturn Ohio, claiming that the Diebold voting machines had been tampered with, because Diebold is a company whose CEOs are Republican. No evidence of it, but that's what they did. Fast forward 2016, they challenged 9 states versus the 6 that Donald Trump challenged. Nobody accused them of engaging in election interference. I thought they had a First Amendment to whine, and I felt that they had every right to file whatever lawsuits they want to. Hillary filed a lawsuit with Jill Stein to overturn Wisconsin. Nobody accused her of undermining the foundation of our republic. Donald Trump does the same thing these guys have been doing for 20 years. All of a sudden, he's Darth Vader. It is unfair. It's a double standard. It's hypocrisy.
Mm. I mean, if only Donald Trump could say those numbers the way you do, Larry. That's not what's going to happen tomorrow night. That's the problem. Is Trump, he's an effective messenger. Don't get me wrong. He got elected president, so you'd have to be.
Right.
But he can't do it the way you can do it. Few of us can.
Well, you know, I when I ran for president, I withdrew from the race, as you know, and Trump invited me to Mar-a-Lago, so we're speaking privately. And I told him much of what I just now told you, and he was entertained by it. And I asked him, this is sort of off topic, I asked him, do you ever 3 o'clock in the morning say to yourself, why the hell did I do this? Mm-hmm. People now won't buy your condos. They won't go to your golf resort. Half the country hates your guts. They think you're Hitler. Your net worth has gone down because of all this. You ever think to yourself, why did I do this? And he went, well, you know, the country is in trouble, blah, blah, blah. He didn't answer my question. So I re-asked it a few minutes later. He didn't answer. We then stood up and took pictures together. And I said, you know, Mr. President, you didn't answer my question. He goes, yeah, I know I didn't.
Really?
So I think that that meant that even Donald Trump, as confident as he is, every now and then says to himself, my goodness.
I also think Trump really is a believer that if there's any negative self-talk, it actualizes. If you just listen to the way he communicates, certainly right. about anything involving himself
right.
or his loved ones, mm-hmm. he never says anything even close to negative. It's baked into him from that positive power the power of positive thinking by Norman Vincent Peale,
right.
who was his pastor when he was growing up.
On that level, I first had a real conversation with him in 2016. We campaigned together. We were at a black church. It was in Detroit, if I'm not mistaken. We had about a 20-minute conversation privately. And this is when he was a candidate, of course. And I said, there's one thing I think you should apologize for. He said, I know what you're going to say. What I said about John McCain. I said, no, I couldn't care less. I said, you said that George W. Bush got us into the Iraq war by lying. I said, however you feel about the war, he did not lie. The intelligence was bad, but he did not lie. I've spoken with Condoleezza Rice privately. I've spoken with Colin Powell privately, and they both said the intelligence was wrong, but nobody lied. And I said, you're giving a talking point that Democrats have used. Ted Kennedy said, week after week after week, they lied and lied and lied. You are giving energy to all of that. And he went, but he never said it again. And I noticed that Donald Trump's way of apologizing is not to say the same wrong-headed thing twice. Mm-hmm. I'm going to take credit for that.
Oh, that's good. All right, wait, we're going to get to the Iraq war in a second, in a way, because Dick Cheney's back in the news.
Yes.
I'm sure you saw that. But
oh, yeah.
Let me finish with this New York Times poll first. This is sort of the headline that's coming out of it when it comes to minority voters, who with whom Kamala is doing better than Joe was, but not as well as your normal Democrat
right.
does. So Trump support among likely black voters, again, this is the New York Times Siena Gold poll, his support among likely black voters back in 2020, it was 7%. In this poll, it's doubled to 14. When it comes to Latino likely voters back in 2020, it was 31%. In this poll, it's gone up 10 points, 41%.
Mm-hmm.
And now the left, I've seen so many of them. It could be an outlier, even the Times this morning. This could be an outlier,
right.
could be an outlier. You know, may not align.
Right.
That tightness of Trump up one instead of down three or four. But do you think it's an outlier, the
no.
doubling the black vote and
no.
up 10 percentage points with Hispanics?
No, he increased his percentage of black vote from 8% in 2016 to 12% in 2020. That's almost a 50% increase. And there are several reasons, but the biggest reason, I believe, is illegal immigration. The cohort most hurt by illegal aliens, and most of these are unskilled with high school or less, are people living in the inner city, black and brown people, against whom they have to compete for jobs. There was a study done by the Civil Rights Commission some years ago. This is before the 12 million illegal aliens have been in the country in the last 3 years.
Yep.
About a million fewer blacks are working because of the presence of illegal alien labor, and illegal alien labor puts downward pressure to the tune of almost $2,000 per year on the salaries of blacks and brown people in the inner city. So the people most hurt by all these people coming into the country are black and brown people, the very people that the left claims that they care about. The second big reason, of course, is the cost of living. The people at the bottom are hurt the most by higher prices, and store prices are up almost 20%, gas prices are up 50%. And the third reason is school choice. The Democrats are adamantly opposed
yes.
to school choice. Urban education in America is a disaster. 85% of black eighth graders, these are 13-year-old kids, Megan, nationwide can neither read nor do math at grade level. In Baltimore, there are 13 public high schools.
Say that again. Wait, just say that last stat one more time.
85% of black eighth graders nationwide, these are 13-year-old kids, can neither read nor do math at grade level.
That is horrifying. You didn't vote for this economic downturn and the high inflation, but you could pay for it at the pump, the grocery store, and with growing stacks of unpaid bills. Financial stress can be crushing, and one solution could be DoneWithDebt.com. Done With Debt created new, aggressive strategies designed to get you out of debt permanently without bankruptcy or loans. Done With Debt can stand between you and your bill collectors, and they'll negotiate with your creditors to write off balances, cut interests, and stop penalties. And the best news is Done With Debt is accepting new clients right now. But you do need to hurry, because some of their debt relief strategies are time sensitive and you don't want to miss out. Let Done With Debt hit the debt reset button for you and make your money yours again. Visit donewithdebt.com or call 1-888-322-1054 right now. Chat with one of their debt relief strategists for free. That's donewithdebt.com, donewithdebt.com. Thanks so much for watching. If you like what you just saw, hit the subscribe button for more clips and full episodes.